Welcome to Mainland Television Regional News. I'm Chrissy Small, and in today's news, serial shoplifter is nabbed, Little's day out, shortcut to be cropped, and more. New signage may help the traffic congestion problem at peak hour along Waimea Road. A new report has failed to address the problem of traffic congestion along Waimea Road, according to Councillor Gail Noonan, who felt that the trail closure last year had been inadequately monitored by staff. Staff were unable to be present the whole 2 weeks and could only attend 2 hours of the 2 days due to money constraints. They then adjusted the research methods to fit the $8,500 budget. The final report was presented to the Works and Infrastructure Committee meeting last week, where councillors ended up voting 4-3 to install a sign at the Wakatū roundabout entrance to Beetson Road, restricting vehicle access to residents only along Beetson Road between 7 and 9 a.m. Monday to Friday. The data had been collected during the trial closure of the road last October, when it was closed to through traffic for 2 weeks, just to measure how the cars used the road as a shortcut and the effect the closure had on travel times along the Waimea Road heading towards the city. The report showed that over the 2 hour peak traffic period, a mere 13 to 15 resident vehicles used the Beetson Road exit at the top of Waimea Road. But when left open as a through road to the public, up to 176 vehicles used it. By closing Beetson Road, the report said, would reduce travel time along Waimea Road by approximately 2 minutes. These signs are due to be installed once the residents, police and NZTA had been spoken to. Committee Chair Eric Davies said the police will be the ones to enforce the regulatory sign, identifying residents by their address on their driver's licence. The Nelson Marlborough Rescue Helicopter had a busy Saturday with 3 emergency flights flown from around the top of the south. Firstly, at around 9 a.m, they attended a 40-year-old packhouse worker in Motueka who sustained injuries to his neck after being struck by a conveyor belt. He was treated by the helicopter's paramedic before being flown to Nelson Hospital. Then around 3:30 p.m, the helicopter was again sent to a scene of a motor vehicle accident on State Highway 6, north of the Whangamowers. A 57-year-old female from Christchurch was the sole occupant in a vehicle which had left the road. This was attended to by other road users and a St John ambulance crew prior to the helicopter's arrival. She was then airlifted in a stable condition to Nelson Hospital. Following this, at 4:30 p.m, the helicopter was dispatched to a motocross accident on the North Bank, Wairau Valley, where an 18-year-old motocross rider from Christchurch sustained a dislocated hip as a result of a heavy landing on his bike. He was treated at the scene by a St John's ambulance crew before being given further care by the helicopter's intensive care paramedic before being flown to Wairau Hospital. Two buildings described as ugly by many when first built on a formerly contaminated site in picturesque Mapua are two of this year's 2015 Nelson Marlborough Architecture Award winners. These two small structures were designed by Irving Smith Jack Architects for the Mapua Waterfront Park. The buildings, one a toilet and the other a pump station, were recognised winners in the small project architecture category. Described by judges as intentionally raw and aesthetic with material elements such as concrete and weathered steel exposed to view, the buildings add to the wider composition of the waterfront park, creating a new identity for this local hub while signalling a new beginning for the remediated chemical site. The Mapua Waterfront Park was once the highly contaminated fruit growers chemical plant site, which the judges now call a community asset, and they said that the new shelter buildings make it emphatically clear that Mapua's park is a place for the people. However, back in June 2013, Mapua residents were not as welcoming for the then new toilet block on the Aranui Waterfront Reserve, which opened at the time to much controversy. Some local business owners were unhappy about the consultation process and felt that their suggestions fell on the deaf ears of the Wellington-based council-employed designers. One of the judges, Craig Potten, told Mainland Television that he was not surprised about the controversy, but the buildings do work to reflect the current industrial look of the cool store and landscape. And today it is another story, as the native grasses grow around these designs and the practical use of these buildings outweigh the aesthetic disapproval from people 2 years ago. Graham O'Brien caught up with some people on the weekend to ask their thoughts.
What's your thoughts on the new Nelson Marlborough Architectural Design Award, Lou, over here?
Well, I think it's really good. It's a standout thing. Everyone can see where it is, and it's also easy on the eye.
I've never really liked the toilet because, you know, there are so many buildings around here already that sort of, you know, reflect the environment. I don't quite know why they didn't use something like that, you know? It's kind of a hard shape.
I think it looks great. It's a good postmodern look. It's fantastic.
Well, that's great because it's been getting a bit of bad press lately, but you think it fits here nicely?
Yeah, I think it's fine. I think they've done a great job.
But, you know, you've got this sort of classic designs around here, and I think it's a shame they didn't reflect that. And I'm a bit worried that the new place that's going up here is going to be the same thing. You know, it's going to be stuck in the environment and not really fit.
A 24-year-old man is in custody and waiting to appear in court on the 26th of May to face charges relating to shoplifting and theft offences. Described as a prolific shoplifter, police say they believe the man has been responsible for a string of shoplifting and petrol drive-off offences in the region. Police have been actively searching for the man and finally located him in Tahuna Nui on the weekend. The Little East Day Out at Victory Centre on the weekend was a great event for the community's small children. Fire engines, Play-Doh, bubble machines, crafts of all sorts, fairies and dancing. What more could parents ask for on a Saturday in their neighbourhood for their children? Graham O'Brien talked with some mothers and the Keep Victory Safe project managers, Marcia Higgs and Gail Peach, about the day and the Victory community.
Marcia, great event you've got here today. You've turned the weather on. Can you tell us a little bit more about the event today?
Yes, Gail and I have been working for Keep Victory Safe, a Keep Victory Safe project, which is part of Victory Community Health, for the last 12, 14 months. And so we wanted to get an event together which brought in families and enabled people to network and see who the support agencies are in the area who can help with the health and well-being of families. So it's all about making stronger individuals, stronger families and stronger community.
And you've certainly done the job extremely well, I must say. Keep Victory Safe is fantastic. And you're carrying on for much longer?
Gail's carrying on till December of this year. My contract finishes in approximately 2 weeks. So this is my swan song to the community and to the project. And it's been an awesome place to work with passionate people. Absolutely loved it. Sad to be leaving, but that's life.
Marcia, thanks very much for all your efforts.
Pleasure. Thank you.
Well, it's a lovely day here. Paula, did you just come down to have some fun with the kids or are you involved here somehow?
I'm a volunteer parent at the Victory Square playgroup. Oh. So I go with my daughter Aubrey. She is 19 months. Yep. And Victory Square playgroup is for 0 to 3 years old. Yeah. Anyone can come down with their children and form some new friendships. Yep.
And you meet many people here yourself?
Yes. Yep. I'm not from Nelson, so I came from Wellington, and it was a great way to meet people, yeah. Other parents with kids the same age, it was wonderful.
And you get to be a participant in these great events?
Yes, part of the community, get to meet everyone and it's fantastic, yep.
Thanks very much, Paula.
You're welcome, thank you.
Hey, what do you think of these great events? It's not often you get to play the peanut butter, is it?
Well, no, this is lovely for the kids. It's excellent, and for the grown-ups too. Good day out.
Definitely something different. I mean, we don't usually play with food so much, do we?
Well, it does happen. Yeah. Yep, it definitely happens in our household.
Great. Is it for the birds or is it for you? Are you going to eat that or is it for the birds?
It's for the birds.
It's for the birds. It's a great day to be out. Are you locals down here? Is that what brings you down today?
No, we've come down from Auckland. Yeah.
Oh, nice. And what do you think of the Little East Day Out?
Oh, it's wonderful. There's heaps of really neat things for all the children to play with. Lots of things to choose from and an amazing centre.
And you think compared to Auckland, you have this sort of little community events where you're from up there?
Yeah, we do. We have lots of fun things on, but this is pretty exceptional. And I'm impressed with all the activities.
Yeah. Nelson landscape photographer Craig Potten has started a fundraiser based at his Nelson Gallery following the Nepal earthquake on April the 25th. This catastrophic event killed more than 7,000 people and injured more than twice as many, and was the biggest disaster to strike Nepal since the last major earthquake in 1934. Potten has travelled to Nepal on several occasions and has an affinity with the majestic landscape, gentle culture, and spiritual communities, which led him to publish two books on the area. The books include Offerings from Nepal, which was a Montana Book Award finalist, and Kathmandu Valley Style, along with framed photographic prints from the books for hugely reduced prices, are all available at the gallery.
Craig, thanks for taking the time to speak to us today. You're having a fundraiser for Nepal. Could you tell us a bit more about this generous offer?
Well, I was pretty shaken, like everyone was, that have been to Nepal, or even just reading about it, knowing about Nepal, like so many Nelsonians, so many New Zealanders do. This earthquake, I mean, it hit in a way that they knew there was going to be an earthquake there, but this one hit a lot worse than any of us could have expected. And places that I've been to many times over there have just gone. I mean, I spent time in Kathmandu City doing a book on it and just wandering around there. And half the places, the streets, the wonderful old buildings have collapsed. And, of course, people died in huge numbers. So it's a bit of a no-brainer for me. I love the place. It's sort of like my second home, the Himalayas and Nepal. And I just had to do something. So this was, frankly, easy compared to what's going on over there.
Sure. And could you tell us a little bit about what's on offer at this fundraiser, please?
Well, a long time ago, I did an exhibition of photographs of Nepal, which you can see straight behind me here. And that was just at a gallery. In fact, it was in America and in New Zealand. And I've exhibited in Australia, too. So I just thought, well, I'll sell that en masse and give all the money from it to Nepal. And then also, I've done a couple of books. One years ago with a good friend, Lisa Chogal, on the whole of Nepal, from the lowlands right to the high mountains and the Kathmandu Valley. And then more recently, one on the architecture of Kathmandu, the main capital city. Wonderful place, got about 8 World Heritage architectural sites in it. So I did this book on the architecture of it. Both those books, I have quite a large number of stock still available, even though they're not in the shops these days. So I thought, well, I'll just sell them off, and all the money from those books and those sales can go to Nepal too.
Oh, that's fantastic, Craig. What a generous offer. How will you get the funds into Nepal? You have a personal connection. Will you be going over there and doing it yourself, or could you please tell us?
No, what I did when I first heard about the earthquake and there were friends asking me, what can you do? I contacted Lisa Chogal. She's the Honorary Council for New Zealand in Kathmandu, a good friend and the person who's written both the scripts to both my books, both the texts. So she was someone who was on site and seeing it all happen and helping out too. And she said that the two best organisations for national reach, for being able to get to the villages and the helicopters and all the aid, were UNICEF and Red Cross. I mean, there's some wonderful groups giving there. Doctors Without Borders, Oxfam, World Vision. There's some wonderful groups. But those two, Red Cross and UNICEF, they've got most people on the ground, and they are really mobilising fast and have mobilised fast. So I thought, well, I'll give it to UNICEF. I've been involved in UNICEF over the years. Yeah, well, I mean, as I say, a lot of New Zealanders and Nelson people have a personal attachment to Nepal, and it's not just because of Ed Hillary, it's because they've gone there. And people go to Nepal because they think wonderful mountains, a bit like the South Island, and what they do is all come away just talking about how wonderful the people are. It's almost like the mountains go into the background, sorry. And the people's, you know, they're poor people, and yet they're people with so much life and so much joy. They teach us how to live well and how to be happy, and that is from some of the poorest people on the planet. And yet they've got something over there that just wins us over. So we really should be doing something for them.
Thanks very much for that, Craig. We hope for a big night and lots of funds to go to help the poor people in Nepal.
Later this month, on Thursday, May 28th, Craig Potten will be holding an evening presentation of his Nepal images to coincide with the Craig Potten Gallery and Stores monthly late night. The event will be free entry. However, Craig welcomes attendees to bring along their spare change for the donation bucket, which will be added to the fundraising total. New Zealand Music Month has been designed to help bring an awareness of our local Kiwi musicians. One group of musicians mainland has been aware of and has followed enthusiastically over the course of a few years are the Smoke Free Rock Quest winners for 2011, The Peasants. whose song Letting Go scored them the opportunity of recording and making a video of that song. In its 23-year history, Smoke Free Rock Quest band successes have included the likes of Midnight Youth, Op Shop, Evermore, Lady Hawk, The Datsuns, Brooke Fraser, The Feelers, Julia Deans, Kimbra and more. The Peasants began their run of winning after winning Richmond's Got Talent as teenagers at the Richmond Mall in 2010. While attending Garran College, they won the New Zealand Smoke Free Rock Quest Music Competition in 2011. The band split late in 2012, shortly after winning a grant from New Zealand On Air. The Peasants could quite happily have been easily one of Nelson's top exports. However, education did get in the way, with lead singer Georgia Knott leaving to attend university in Auckland, where her brother Caleb, a former member of the Peasants, was also studying. They formed a duo which they called The Broods in 2013. They then began a collaboration with music producer Joel Little, who had been a judge at the 2011 Smoke Free Rock Quest. He also produced Lorde's 2013 hit single Royals. The Broods' first single, Bridges, debuted at number 8 in New Zealand Singles Chart in 2014 and was chosen as the US iTunes Store Single of the Week in February 2014. They have since signed with Capitol Records worldwide and Polydor in the UK and Europe in December 2013. They released their debut album, Evergreen, in August last year, which debuted at number 1 on the New Zealand album chart, winning them Best Breakthrough Artist of the Year at the 2014 New Zealand Music Awards. They were also nominated for the APRA Silver Scroll Award for the singles Bridges. The band made their debut US performance in Hollywood, California on the 24th of February 2014, then in the UK at London's Notting Hills Arts Club in March, touring briefly with Haim, followed by a tour of North America, then Australia in support of Ellie Goulding. Finally returning to the US to make their television debut on Late Night with Seth Meyers in July and touring in support of Sam Smith. This year, they returned to North America for the headlining tour. After the break, we'll bring you the latest weather update and some events and happenings coming up from around the region.
Welcome, me hearties, to Smuggler's Pub and Cafe. Famous for hearty meals, craft ales and a friendly service way. Sensational seasonal menus with meals all day and evening too. Or sail in for a snack with special menus for young smugglers and you. Settle in for a jolly old time. Relax and enjoy our award-winning dining and lovely fine wine. Decked out in an old-worldly way, we're open 7 days. Book or come on in to 8 Muirutai Street, not far from a beach, walk or swim. Phone 546408.
Hey, I'm Francis from Nelson Auto Glass. We repair all auto glass, stone chips, windscreen replacements, scratch removal.
If you have an auto glass issue, our team will sort it.
Nelson Auto Glass Specialist, 84 Vanguard Street, Nelson.
Hi everyone, I'm Malcolm Harris from The Facilitators. We now look after sales for mainland TV, radio, Sky and online. New Zealand On Air's latest Colmar Brunton survey confirms mainland's large multimedia audience. If you're in business or want to put a message out to everyone in the Nelson-Tasman region, plus nationwide on Sky or worldwide online, please give me a call or see our website at www.mainlandtv.nz.
The Shed.
Discover the Belgrove Tavern, just 20 minutes south of Richmond on State Highway 6. A restaurant, functions, weddings, barbecue, a garden bar with lots of room for kids. Come and see us.
We're the team at JCAR. Right here in Nelson, 120 Hardy Street. Our shop is full of electronic items,
including security alarm systems, electronic components,
solar and power,
electronics, toys.
Sound systems, cables and much, much more. Jacob.
120 Hardy Street, Nelson.
Victory 60 Plus is on Tuesdays at 1:30 through to 3:30pm at 238 Upper Vanguard Street. You can join in for cards, games and a cuppa.
Sit and Be Fit is on at the Victory Community Centre Tuesdays and Thursdays at 10am at the Victory Community Church, 238 Upper Vanguard Street. School terms only. Fun while you get fitter, work at your level. For more information, please contact Shirley on 547 1433 or 021 121 8023.
On behalf of the team here at Mainland Television News, thank you for joining us, and we'll bring you the latest news and events from around the region again tomorrow.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on air.
G'day, it's your old mate the Mad Butcher, and you're watching Mainland TV.
Hi, my name's Ian Mortimer. Mortimer Auto Upholstery is your one-stop shop for all your upholstery needs. We do car and boat interiors, boat canopies, ute tonneau covers, canvas and PVC fabrication. Call in and see us in Oxford Mews, 72 Oxford Street, Richmond.
Are you looking for a scooter, walker, wheelchair, baby seats or pushchairs? Then come in and see the Nelson Region Specialist at Mobility for You, 269 Queen Street, Richmond, opposite the library. We have a huge selection of scooters, walkers, wheelchairs and accessories, along with a free booklet guide. We also provide a breakdown service if you ever get a puncture or a flat battery. We have fully equipped service vans to rescue you. Hi, I'm Robin Jordan, and I invite you to call in and see the friendly team at Mobility for You, 269 Queen Street, Richmond, opposite the library.
World War I was a defining period in our history, impacting greatly on the lives of people from the Nelson Province. Memories of the First World War is an exhibition which will be displayed in a number of regional venues and is currently on at the Nelson Provincial Museum.
Why would you want to pay as much as $1,000 for a single bed mattress when you can buy a high quality locally made mattress like this for as little as $220? And a queen size mattress could cost you in excess of $3,000, but at Nelson Beds you could have a mattress like this as low as $425. So why would you go out and spend a fortune on your child's bedroom when you can come to Nelson Beds and buy a complete single mattress and base set, a 7-drawer Scotch chest, a headboard and a 3-drawer bedside cabinet for as little as $979? So call and discuss our custom manufacturing options and local after sales service at Nelson Beds, Nelson's only bedding manufacturer.
Nelson Tire Center, great prices, great service. Buy your own Bryford trailer, all types, all sizes. See Colin Douglas for your tires and batteries.